Hello, this is Kania Sungsu, making a video from the Netherlands. Don't mind me, it's very choky, high humidity and warm here. So I am a mess. I'm keeping something to drink nearby because it's really, really warm. It's like 30, but the humidity in the Netherlands gets like off the scale. So it's a... a lot of headaches lately. Anyway, I wanted to say something. Peter Zeihan, just I adore the guy, he's very funny, recently did something about UFOs or unidentified aerial phenomena, or China has its own acronym, I don't know. I would say weird stuff in the sky. It's a very interesting field right now. Looking outside, looking from the outside, is incredibly difficult as an uninformed observer to make any proper assessment about it. What the hell's happening? You see videos where pilots say that's really weird. So you automatically conclude there is a thing flying and that thing changes course, so it must be something of a technology we don't have any idea about. Well, that kind of doesn't make any sense whatsoever. So I wanted to take this down to analyze this in three steps. I've listened to the pop culture analysis of Peter Zeihan, which is, he just needs to say something. That is his business model. He gets questions and he just blurts out an answer or an analysis or a statement, which is, in this case, he made a bullshit statement, but yeah, that's what he does. 99% of his statements are extremely competent and thought-provoking, but this one was just a crap. he knew it was crap, but he had to say something to his concerned audience. So, I want to take in these three steps, but I'm doing this off the cuff like everything I do in my life, just improvised. Let me go by my planning. I am going to look at the reality of intelligence agencies making statements about UFOs. It may not be in this order, but first I'm going to make a statement about intelligence agencies making statements about it. I'm going to take into account the analysis of Snowden. Maybe I'm trying to conjecture and form my thoughts on the spur of the moment. What you can say about what's happening, what motives are of certain players in the field, the terrestrial field. Then we're going to say something about the universe at large and technology and things we know and things we just don't know. And then I'm going to say something about the likelihood or the implications of if something's happening, what could it be? If you really have to find an answer, what the hell could it be? What would be the implications of certain things? And I'm going to conclude it with a conclusion. If there's actually something visiting us, it must be in this sort of category. It's a bit of Sherlock Holmes. It can't be this because it's bullshit, as far as we know. And it can't be that because that's even worse bullshit. So it has to form into several very narrow categories of things that it could be, or would be, or should be, if the premises are all correct. A good friend of mine who was until recently staying in El Gato in near Mountain View near San Francisco. I've known her for over 10 years, and she was really into the UFO stuff. But what should I say and stay polite? I don't buy into it. And I'm chalking it down to UFO stuff quite often is personality disorder stuff or people generating an income from making vault culty statements. I don't buy into it. So first, let me start with my personal conviction. That's tricky. I'm not sure. I'm not 100% sure either way. I would lean mostly towards this is all bullshit. This is, there are no machines. Even you can't even say machines there. There are no intelligent life. You can't even say that. Say you have a phenomena. Is that intelligent life? Is that a manifestation of intelligent life? As far as we understand, it would be something like that, but it's not certain. I think there's absolutely nothing. There's no machines. There is no alien dimensional stuff. There's no robots. There's no drones. There's nothing. Right now, the cameras are so detailed. You hear so many stories about UFOs. How on the one hand, on the other hand, cameras have a resolution you wouldn't believe. So there should be like a torrent of evidence, very hard evidence, very detailed images of UFOs coming our way, and that's not happening. And I don't want to go immediately conspiracy like Men in Black suppressing everything. No, I don't believe that. First, how to make sense of the torrent of statements in the US Congress. So you have a US Congress or the government, and there's like hearings, and there's the desire for disclosure. Guys, we have phenomena, and not just in America, but everywhere, Brazil, China, Russia, everywhere there are sightings, and there are even more than sightings, like a first encounters, second level encounters, third level encounters, and even like fourth level encounters, like active interaction. There is the constant, the whole buzz of conspiracies, the people trying to suppress. So I casually, jokingly discussed this with my friend Amanda, and she says, yeah, I think that there is like super technology available, amazing technology. It's all human, and it's far advanced to the official statements. I don't agree with her. I vehemently don't agree with her in this field. She will correct me and says, "Yeah, but I didn't say that, and I said something else, and nuance it." For the viewer, let's keep it very simple. I have another authority who's well informed in technology matters, and she says, most likely. Officials have a certain level of technology, and behind the scenes there is significantly more advanced technology, and that is do able to do things that we that are unprecedented and unthinkable and beyond any known paradigm. I don't agree with that. I vehemently don't agree with that. That would be signs of that. That would be indicators of that. It would be obvious, more obvious. I see no signs that humans. Either secret agencies or conspiracies or whatever behind the scenes have anything like the technology suggestive of aliens or machines or craft or drones or robots or whatever kind of phenomenon you will care to call it, label it, that are able to do the things are reported. Yeah, that makes it an uncomfortable mystery, as far as I'm concerned at this stage. So, on the one hand, the government or certain aspects of the government or certain witnesses say these things. They want disclosure. They say, guys, we have to look at this more carefully because really weird shit's happening. And those witness statements are amazingly interesting. And often they sound very hard. So if you see like an object over the sea moving, and the pilots are just in an uproar about it, what they're seeing, how do you interpret that? As especially as someone who isn't super informed about technology and about the bigger picture, I think I am to a degree, but not super specialist. Like I have a sort of a top-down view, and how do you parse that? How do you make sense of that? And to be honest, it's a mystery. I can't make sense of that. There is, in my mind, an enormous discrepancy against the witness statements, the technological reality, and what you see in the field, the sort of world at large. That is, it does not make sense whatsoever. That's a mystery. And when it comes to mysteries, I need solid statements and evidence and a lot better explanations or a lot better hypotheses or theories for me to actually get any intuition. I right now have no intuition whatsoever. I have no idea. So. Sorry, this is just so incompetent. Next, the bigger picture. This is going to be extremely non-intuitive. This is what I'm going to say right now. The picture I'm going to paint is going to fly completely contrary to your intuition. But I will try to do it sort of like a simulation. Like I'm going to paint you some like invite you to paint a simulation in your head. In your head, try to visualize what I'm saying. The universe is something like 14,000 million years old. So there was an inexplicable event where the universe very quickly inflated, and quickly after, relatively speaking, fairly quickly after, material objects formed. The universe would have looked considerably different back then. There would be phenomena in the universe we have not really an understanding of. There would be very strange stars that you see no explanation, but they still produce energy because of dark matter interactions, most likely. There would be sudden mass collapses that stops in their tracks being repulsed by something. There would be very strange black holes. There would be stars that are bigger than anything we've seen and heavier than like thousand solar mass stars, very quickly collapsing, being held aloft by dark matter annihilation pressure, most likely, and then they very quickly dissolve into black holes of a mass of thousands or tens of thousands the mass of the sun. Those were the Titanic ages. Now, in the first part of the galaxy, the only substance of meaning was either hydrogen or helium. So the universe created hydrogen, helium, and a smattering of other elements such as lithium, etc. But there was not enough stuff to make things. You cannot make organics or intelligences or beings or species from hydrogen or helium or a smattering of carbon and lithium. That just doesn't happen. Then the universe went through cycles of enrichment through fusion to exploding stars, etc. Note that stars that explode, nova, supernova, enrich the universe in materials, but they don't enrich the universe in everything. Then you have to go through several other cycles of star destruction to create heavy elements. For instance, gold is to a large degree created, as far as we know, not by supernova, not by exploding white dwarf explosion novas type 2, or any other way, except the merger of neutron stars. And there is quite a bit of gold on Earth. You would say a lot, but there's plenty of gold, enough to be shocking that all that gold is literally created. Literally, if you have a ring, the gold on your finger, a golden ring, or on your teeth, it was literally created several hundred meters away or several kilometers away from the formation of a black hole. So two neutron stars, they were orbiting very quickly. Their orbit became shorter and shorter and shorter because they pull on the universe, on the space-time continuum that radiates shockwaves away, you know, woof, 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 every rotation. And the rotations went at a rate of like every millisecond. neutron stars are very bright, so you can't even be very close to them. You have to be billions of kilometers away from them, and then they create all kinds of radiation pressure effects. You can't even observe this from a close distance. And then the shockwave of the two neutron stars merging would be so powerful that it deposits energy until a very significant distance. I would say up to the distance of the solar system, so several 10 billion kilometers, it would cause so much shockwave damage. Literally the universe pulses and that deposits energy and matter, and that matter would be vaporized or pushed or otherwise disrupted. So there's no way to put this into words that makes sense. How do you postulate the sun, which is 700 million kilometers, into a condensed ball of matter that's just a few kilometers, just 5-10 kilometers, and then two of them, and they orbit, merge, form a black hole, and some of that matter, like the black hole, the two neutron stars form black hole, and a lot of stuff gets swirled out in an explosion. Then no words. There's no frame of references. You can't, like, let's say the most powerful explosion on the sun is quite impressive. It is a fractional, marginal thing compared to this kind of energies. They call it a hypernova. Hypernovas are bright, but not super bright. They just produce a lot of stuff in other wavelengths that you don't see. Supernovas are very bright. Hypernovas are significantly less bright, but more energetic, strangely enough, because they emit material. So returning to the point here, the universe was cyclically enriched in explosions. Now, at first, those explosions were rare and had a different quality, a significant different quality. It takes quite a while for those neutron star explosions to occur with any level of frequency in the galaxy. So the first billions of years, there was boring stuff, hydrogen, smattering of other elements. You can't have complex reactions there. So it takes at least 5 to 7 billion years for the universe to be so enriched in stuff other than hydrogen and helium, what astrophysicists called metals, that you can actually see planets that make sense. Probably, most likely, the first 5, 6, 7 billion years, there were no planets with solid surfaces. There were just gas puffs, gas clouds, planets, or mostly watery ice planets. Before things make sense. Very interesting component of this is in the formation of life. You probably, and that's a prevailing theory right now, you need phosphorus. And phosphorus is pretty rare. On Earth, we risk rather severe agricultural crisis because phosphorus is running out. So in the next hundreds of years, we have to get that phosphorus somewhere else. The asteroids have quite a bit of phosphorus. So we probably have to go to asteroids. The moon isn't even suitable for this. You have to go to asteroids and literally deep mine asteroids in order to have the phosphorus, in order to keep industrial society and agricultural, major agricultural society going. But that also means that the universe takes time to seed enough pollution. Pollution is a shitty word, but background content of phosphorus. And it goes for a whole bunch of elements. It's not that life needs all those elements. Most likely life needs phosphorus because the most complex organochemistry you can make needs phosphorus, as far as we know. There are not known alternatives, most likely. There are no alternatives, major alternatives for complex chemistry or complex reactions. Phosphorus is an important one. Carbon is, of course, a major important one, but it's a very limited list. And in the future, will we have more enrichment of materials, more iron, more lead, more anything that isn't radioactive decaying. Any stable elements will increase in percentage in the universe, slowly but surely over billions of years. So the amount of reactions that might be conceivable in the future, or that occur in the future, of which we not have a good intuition right now, maybe a high level element over heavier than iron becomes a constituent factor in organochemistry of the distant future. But right now we have to make it with carbon, phosphor, and so that creates a pretext of the formation of life. The formation of life starts becoming plausible, likely, probable, several billion years. So that leaves from the 14 billion years about half. In that half, we're talking 7,000 million years. The prevailing theories and the prevailing analysis are somewhat solid. It takes about 3 billion years to come up with complex life. And complex life, I mean stuff that can move around with ambulatory organs, call it feet or legs, that can pick up stuff, that can manipulate environment, and that has the physical resilience to handle the environment in a rich environment where you can manipulate things. In terms of humans, we're talking about stone axes and a little nests and huts and etc. Now, birds make nests, but that is an instinct. That is not a conscious analysis. A little. For instance, birds are improvising and they take a little bit of plastics and make interesting new nests. There is the gradual incremental evolutionary depositing or even learning and teaching. The young are taught things by their the young birds or primates or animals are taught things that weren't possible 50 years, 100 years ago. So you definitely see a shift in behavioral changes over time, very gradual, but nothing like humans. Humans can be taught in several years, months even, completely new field of understanding and manipulating the world, say engineering, and then those humans can be made to do new things in just months, fundamentally new things of manipulating reality. And that brings us to brains. Now, as far as we know, as far as we understand, as far as we can conjecture, as far as it's plausible, it takes a damn long time for simple organic life to form. And then the planet on which it forms, or the environment it forms, because it doesn't always have to be a planet, but the environment which it forms has to have certain qualities. It has to sort of have a geology, which is might be very rare or relatively rare, or it might have a it needs an environment that pushes life to complexify. And now, if people don't believe in evolution, this discussion ends. If you say there's a God, or there's a creative process, or there is a higher order, or there's metaphysical stuff going on, this discussion becomes pointless. This discussion hinges on the current understanding of science, on the current understanding of evolution. It takes a damn long time for life to have the simple qualities of procreation, enrichment, taking and forming cellular stuff, like pond scum, slime, green stuff on the edge of your aquarium. That is going to take at least several billion years. And then suddenly, fairly suddenly on Earth, might go different on other planets, but arguably the one example we have on Earth is the Cambrian explosion. Suddenly we had like plants and forests and on the land and crawly things. Now, if humans had a time machine, which they won't and don't and won't ever, most likely, and go back to the Cambrian era, which is millions of tens of millions of years, you would see life that was not particularly impressive. You say the Cambrian explosion and there's like a suddenly life. If you go before the Cambrian, you see the landscape of Iceland, sort of some moss here and there, but no animals, no trees, no stuff, no complex stuff. And then you fast forward 100 million years, and then there's these ferns, and there's like slimy ponds, and there's little shrubs, and there's crawly things. Now, looking at those crawly things in the Cambrian, in the late Cambrian, you would think, oh, that's disgusting. You see very fragile, crawly, cockroachy, piss ant things how do you call these things? Little ambulatory slimy things. You push on them, you say, they are soft, they are squishy, they are slow, they move slow. And fast forward 100 million years and you have something that is precursor to mammals. They look like the most ugly pigs you can imagine, with like ugly teeth. They're about as big as my dog. They are grunting about, but even then you would say this life looks simple. It life was operating under evolutionary pressures that were, it requires quite a bit of time to make life faster, stronger, meaner, resilient. As far as you go back in time, the organisms, the more underwhelming you would qualify them. So that we're talking like 500 million years now. The last 500 million years, stuff started happening, and ever faster and ever meaner. 200 million years ago, you would still say dinosaurs, those Giganotosaurus, there, the Tyrannosaurus Rex of 50, 60, 70 million years ago. That's 200 million years of dinosaurs. That's 200,000 times 1,000 years. So the entire human history times 1,000, something like that. That's the era of dinosaurs. As far as we know, the precursor requirements for intelligent, complex neurology, environment manipulating life occurred tens of millions of years ago. 100 million years? No, that's not likely. You can't make thinking stuff, abstract thinking stuff from the creatures that were there. The smallest mammals were nothing, small little crawly creatures. The biggest animals didn't have the neurology. They had brains like this. You cannot make an industrial society with brains like that, as far as you understand, as far as we can right now model in our understanding. The first animals that probably could do that were tens of millions, or maybe 20 or so, or less than 20 million years ago. We find no fossil records of creatures that would say, yeah, those guys are going to make rockets and go into space. They don't have the manipulative organs. Life kind of stumbles into complexity and ever more gradient complexity and competitiveness. You have to be quite competitive as a creature, and I would say ambitious, forward striving. There's also a component of pathology. How can you say that? There's a pathological component in human primate, human behavior, where we do things that are not in the interest of individual species, or have a component of systemic ruthlessness in our organization of society that is not fun or can be interpreted as pleasant. We are predatory to ourselves. Quite predatory and quite sadistical. We treat our fellow organic life with a ruthlessness that would make you scream hysterical fear. How we use our cattle animals, it would be a war crime or Nuremberg level of ruthlessness. However, nobody beats an eye, nobody. Even 99% of people don't even realize how ruthless, systemically ruthless, the human cognition substrate mind is right now, and will be for some time. How evolutionary mean and methodical it is. Right now, we probably in the first decades, that where we can postulate nicely as a universal axiom, where we can say, let's be nice. David Pearce does a lot of thinking, philosopher David Pearce does a lot of thinking about this. What if we instill niceness in life from now on? Would that be good? Would that niceness ruin our rationality and our capacity to deal with the universe at large? or would it be just the way to go? Anyway, so humans emerge, humans muddle around, and we're talking like a time scales of are 7 billions, then 3 or 4 billions where life sort of emerges as pons come, and then 500 million where life becomes ambulatory, plant like trees, but not very impressive, like cockroaches all over the planet, like little slimy, slow moving cockroaches. And then hundreds of million years, big organic things, dinosaurs, reptiles, birds, and then some mass extinctions, like a smattering of mass extinctions almost constantly. There's a lot of space in mass for mass extinctions every several million years. If you have hundreds of million years, those mass extinctions allow evolution to become meaner and more cutthroat, ruthless, and you need that. It's sad to say, but in order to come up with life that conquers the universe, you need quite persistent life. And persistence can be equated as mean, kick-ass, so to speak. So that is the human example, that is the terrestrial example. That's how things went on Earth, and you can extrapolate quite a bit for the rest of the universe. Now, there is people who say this is super rare. Earth or the pre-Earth was hit by, Theia was hit by an object, and that object created like a swirling Earth and a moon, and that Earth had, because of the impact of Theia 3 billion years ago, has an active geology. No planets in the solar system have a meaningful active geology, so it requires a very rare series of events to create an active geology. You need an active geology in order to have plate tectonics, in order to have a water cycle, in order to have a good smattering of elements on the surface, in order to allow the complexity of life. Then you need a day-night cycle in order to push life to work in cycles. Then you need seasons, because the Theia was hit by an object, a planet, and it created a wobble, and we call that seasons. And then life has to acclimatize on seasons, and it becomes more resilient, more creative, more flexible because of all those set of precursors. And then we look at the solar system, and we see that other solar systems might have less phosphorus or other trace elements. So you might have a universe which is mostly devoid of life because there isn't enough seeding of quintessential precursor elements in order to allow for life to seed. So there's a bunch of scientists and philosophers and astrobiologists and whatever that say this is rare stuff. But on the other hand, there's people who say this shit happens everywhere. If it doesn't find one solution, it will find another solution. The question is, how much time do we have in order to do that? What is the window of opportunity for an order of life to create? Now, bad news, that the window of opportunity started maybe 500 billion years ago, all bunch of mass extinctions, and it's ending probably 100 million years in the future. So 100, 200 million years in the future, the ability, the petri dish, the factory of Earth surface is going to die down. Geology, active geology is going to die down, and the result will be that that wonderful experiment is going to end. In 200 million years ago, we're going to see, if nothing happens, if humanity is gone, etc., and Earth models on as it is right now, in 200, 250 million years, the last complex life organisms are going to die. Shortly after, plant life is going to die because of complex aspects of oxygen. There's going to be more and more oxygen in the atmosphere. Climate change is going to end, and the Earth is going to get hotter because the sun gets progressively hotter and it's becoming a desert. The continents coming together, and the geology is going to die down. Trace elements are going to percolate down into the ocean, and it's becoming more progressively more boring. BBC made an amazing The Future's Wild, you have to watch it. There you will see the statement that 200 million years from now it's winding down, and that is the window of opportunity for us, for Earth, for terrestrial life, to come up with complex, competing, ambitious, forward-moving, flexible, creative, manipulative organochemistries. There is people who say there was a good theory about this, about gravity aliens, which suggests that life is around that's the rare precursors that come up with our set of solutions. There might be other set of solutions, but our particular set of solutions, our stack of tools, set our toolbox, terrestrial life comes up with a toolbox, and that is humanity, and humanity is going to see the universe. Let's get lucky. There's people who say that, and the guy from the gravity theory, gravity alien theory, what's his name? He suggests, he conceives of the analysis that such life is probably interspersed over distances of millions of galaxies. So humanity is so rare that it's not in this galaxy. That's only very occasionally happening somewhere in the galaxy that might have a chance. So far, it doesn't have had a chance. It didn't have a chance. There's no other intelligent life. There's lots of life in the galaxy. The universe, probably every few systems has pond scum. Every few hundred systems has simple organic life. Every few thousand star systems in the galaxy out of 100 billion have complex ambulatory life. And maybe there is several million planets where there is stuff you can kill with a stick. You can run after it, you can spear it, and then you have a dead animal that is literally dead. There's animals. What's his name? Someone did an amazing book. I have that book somewhere. Expedition. I think it's Barlow. I have it. Yeah, William James Barlow. I absolutely adore this guy. I bought his books in the 1970s and 1980s. This guy has been going around for ages. Expedition is the best analysis of a planet where there is the complex level of life. And amazingly, it's like next door in the universe, which is arguably very unlikely. Why is this unlikely? Well, if you have creatures, extremely odd statistical aberrations such as humanity that is able to make tools, it doesn't take particularly long for those tools to escalate. And that escalation, let me impress upon you what a unique time we are all living. For thousands of years, the escalation was already happening, but from our perspective, fairly gradual. For tens of thousands of years, nothing much happened except a few grunting primates with sticks and stones and spears. But it was already quite impressive. And then we evolved to fire and metalworking and building houses and shelters, etc. And then we evolved to states, and we're talking ever more complexity and incremental. That is a graph that is definitely already on the incline thousands of years ago. And if you compress that graph, the amount of unique things, developments, evolutionary steps, scientific revolutions, bouncingly forward, axioma shifts, paradigm shifts, meaningful stuff happening very quickly, is like on an incline. So that incline is now going functionally vertical compared to everything in the past thousands of years, or hundreds of thousands, or millions or billions of years ago. Something new happens. There's no indication that this happened before on Earth. Could be, but it left no trace whatsoever, no geological trace. If intelligent creatures would look back in time a billion years from now, you would find a black layer of, we call that the Anthropocene boundary layer. Like there is a boundary layer, the K2 boundary layer, where a giant asteroid hit. You find trace elements, isotopes there, indicative of what the asteroid is like. You would, in the future, a million years from now, also find like an anthropogenic layer of black soot, plastics, and the results of nuclear testing, and maybe a few nuclear wars by then, and whatever. But that would be a very indicative layer. You would look at for fossils, and you would eventually found sort of like fossilized remains of microcircuitry. A good archaeological study 10 million years from now, of that boundary layer would reveal scientific principles to those future intelligent tool using ambitious aliens or creatures that come after us, not aliens, like our fellow terrestrial beings. But most likely, this is our chance. Right now, humanity is wreaking so much impact on, I can't call it damage, it is a side effect of industrial society just emerged, and now it's doing stuff to the planet, and it's creating so much impact that, this is our one shot. You cannot have, most likely you can't have a second industrial revolution after this one. We wreck the planet for at least tens of millions of years. And if you look at the future, the chances on life having the geological richness, the mineral richness, etc., 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 in the future, let's say 20, 30, 40 million years ago, quickly descends until 200 million years from now, it's gone. The tube of toothpaste is empty. The can is empty. Earth doesn't produce, yield the richness in order to do this stunt again. Maybe we get two shots. Maybe life on this planet get two shots. That's rather irrelevant for me, but maybe. But I don't think so. I think this is the one shot. And an explosion of events happens now. It's literally, if you compress a graph, it's literally, the graph goes up, goes up, boom, and goes vertical. The amount of meaningful changes, the amount of meaningful revolutions, advances, progress, literally measurable objective progress, is happening now. And that results in either humanity destroying itself, or not actively destroying itself, and not going to destroy itself, but dying as a result of the side effects of this progress, and then extinguishment, or an endless whimper of, like, the world turns into 20,000-40,000 years of Afghanistan, and then it just ends. So there's people with Kalashnikovs for thousands of years, but no more meaningful industrial progress. It could be. A very well-known guy on internet, on YouTube, said, Isaac Arthur, disagrees with me, but I am very pessimistic. If we ruin our shots, it's probably over. That the world is going to be so systemically pathological that can't create a new industrial revolution. I don't see a new industrial revolution with when there's factions with nerve gas around. The amount of aggression inherent in a complex organic evolved life, combined with nuclear weapons, with Kalashnikovs, with explosive IEDs, and it's literally going to be not a racist statement, but just an analysis, sort of like a thousands of years of Somalia, or worse, and then slowly humanity withers away into not existing. And then you will have new life, and new life will spread over the earth. There will be new forests, and there will be maybe like a life adapting to nuclear waste at some places. I don't know. But there could be new opportunities down the road. But it does, if we ruin most organic life on the planet with whatever catastrophe we harvest, it takes millions of years for that organic life to come up with complex creatures with hands and feet and brains, etc. Maybe next time it will be the rats. But it won't be the chimpanzees. The chimpanzees will all be gone. The dolphins will all be gone. The whales will all be gone. Everything will be eaten or extinct. So we have to start from scratch from very small animals. Rats, most likely, something like that. So our chances occur within a limited time frame, and that we have to move into the galaxy fairly quickly. It has to be done in the next century. It's just an absurd statement. And if you talk at this in the context of this Earth and history and geological time, this stuff, this unique, miraculous stuff, this absolutely statistically anomalous stuff has to happen in years, decades, centuries. I would even be full of hubris and say it has to happen in my lifetime, what is left of it at least. It stands to reason that this doesn't happen very often in the universe, and if it happens, it generally goes wrong. ask the Future of Life Foundation. My dog is going insane. Are you attacking your own tail, you low neurology lump of lard? Never mind, bull terriers are nuts. And so the guy who came up with the Gravity Life, what's the guy's name? Never mind, you'll find it. That scientists postulate this happens only every many millions of galaxies. So you look at the universe and there, you can't even see the galaxy where this is happening right now. And he postulates that at some point humanity will spread about the galaxy, will move to other galaxies, form a bubble, and then the bubbles will touch, and then the universe will be consolidated for intelligent life. I won't say much about that, except that we can make very little statements about it. Now, let me go back a few steps. Moving from solar system to solar system is hard, but not impossible. It is conceivable with our technology. With our current technology, and we're talking Project Daedalus, nuclear propulsion, fusion, ramjet scoops, or whatever. With our current technology, with the technology we have in the 1950s even, it's possible to make an object that can move to another star in an acceptable, appreciable amount of time with a low risk amount of feasibility. So let's say 1 in 3 of those starships arrives after a voyage of 200 years. That is a complexity, is like building a million Manhattans. That is an enormous industrial undertaking to get that thing into space, to get the infrastructure in space, erect the infrastructure in space, build a spaceship, and then eject it from the solar system. It moves to Alpha Centauri, Proxima Centauri, or whatever, Barnard Star, or probably all of them at the same time. So like you have the solar system, and then like a swarm of those spaceships move. They create colonies. It might be that those colonies fail. Some of them won't fail. There will be industrial societies there, and the panspermiation of new spaceships will occur there, all assuming 1950s, 1960s technology. So it's possible with rather archaic technology from like 50, 60, 70 years ago to move, scatter across the universe. So if aliens or God or angels or whatever would come and impose a technological limit on us, and you say your technology is not longer advanced, we could, with the technology we have, easily conquer the universe. Now, how fast? Now, most pessimistic scenario, and I've literally had an argument with Gerard het Hooft, the Nobel Prize guy. He says, nah, this won't happen for millions of years. And I argued, according to some people successfully, this could happen in centuries. You could have the first interstellar travel, an enormous sacrifice in several hundred or several tens of decades. With current technology, and if technology advances significantly, it can be progressively better. Now visualize this. Aliens, and I'm seeing that I'm already at 48 minutes. We are arguably, if we are slightly lucky, and it's not even luck, it's likely that we're going to pull this off, likely, plausible, that we're going to go into the solar system and from the solar system into interstellar space, and that we are gradually going to create infrastructure in interstellar space, let's say tens of billions of kilometers, and then slowly we jump off the continental shelf of the solar system and move our little spaceships to another system. Maybe 1 in 3 will fail, maybe 9 out of 10 will fail, but eventually some of them will make it, like little spermatozoids into interstellar space. We don't know how difficult it is. We don't know how deadly interstellar space is. We don't know the failure rates, but this is doable. This is thinkable, even at enormous loss, even at enormous death, even at failure rates you wouldn't believe, it's doable. And now comes the kicker. Organic life has existed, complex organic life, the capacity of the universe to do organic, amazing, organic, complex things hands and brains and everything for hundreds of millions of years, maybe longer. Maybe there were occasionally incidental star systems with the complexity and the organic seeding and the prerequisites of creating intelligent life. And it could have happened. And that basically means somewhere in the galaxy could have been a thing, a little creature with tools and nuclear weapons and whatever, alternatives of all that, into its solar system, into its interstellar space. How long does it take for it to travel? Now, the most pessimistic rate with current or even slightly archaic technology from the 1960s, the most pessimistic scenario with current understanding of material science and nuclear propulsion and evaporation of propulsion systems, and the most negative scenario, the most pessimistic scenario, is a rate of 1 light year every 100 years. So let's say we start doing this crazy stuff several hundred years from now. 1,000 years from now, we should definitely be, given a little bit of luck, be Alpha Centauri, and several centuries from now, beyond Alpha Centauri, and several centuries beyond that, maybe even further, and technology keeps advancing at the same time. So the rate of spreading will definitely increase. It won't be as slow, but let's be pessimistic. Let's say that the universe has an inherent quality of spreading around, of intelligent tool using life, of 1 light year per century. The galaxy is 100,000 light years. So that basically means that stuff from not one, but numerous potential intelligent tool using complex neurology life would be scattering over the galaxy in the time span of several million years. While the universe is 14,000 million years. So the discrepancy between the length of the universe and the arguable, plausible, likely, completely sound ability of at least our intelligent type of life to spread is inconsistent. That's Fermi's paradox. Look it up, Google it. Look at the solutions of the Fermi paradox. It's all permutations on the same conclusion. And if you look at how much difference there is between 1900 and the year 2000, the cities in 1900 were visible, but they're a long way off from the cities of the year 2000. That's a lot of industrial potential. Internet and cars and airplanes, that's 100 years. So okay, imagine that over hundreds of years. So the violence, violence is not the word, the impactfulness, the systemic aggression of industrial society, as soon as it gets off planet, is going to be exponentially bigger than what it is now. That makes noise. That guarantee you, that is going to be loud. That's going to be visible. Right now, if hypothetical, say human terrestrial life equivalent creatures are looking around the galaxy, they look and they see humanity. We are making a little bit of noise, but a few centuries from now, we are definitely making more noise. A few thousand years from now, a lot more noise. The nature of the noise I can only speculate about, but consider it an extension of the noise you would see in any industrial environment. Radiation, little telltale chemical signature signs. Right now, our visibility bubble is maybe several tens of light years. So the best scientific equipment looking around, humanity would see humanity several tens of year light. An equivalent humanity several tens of light years away would already be sending signals or doing large-scale observation of us. 1,000 years from now, that will be a significant part of the galaxy. So humanity, thousands years from now, will have emitted signs thousands of light years, and tens of thousands of years of light years, other equivalent humans in the galaxy, arguably more than one, would be counter-observing that emission of activity. So that noise we emit would be observed ever more poignantly, like exhibitionistically. Like, there's humanity, look at them go, look at them, making the noise, making all these radio emissions and all the chemical stuff happening and all that fence permeation happening. It's there, they are loud, they are grabby, they're expanding. There is this enormously frustrating inconsistency in that. That's just a few million years. Why hasn't it happened yet? Makes no sense. Now, it is seductive to say about UFOs, oh, that's them. That's them. They're here. So 50 million years, someone started traveling and they came here. Makes no sense. And that's what's so objectively wrong about the analysis of, what's his name? Never mind. When someone makes an analysis about aliens and hyperspace and all that stuff. Let me continue this in the next video. So this is video number one about, how am I going to call this? The UFO mystery? The UFO conundrum? Yeah, let's call it the UFO conundrum. And video two will be, again, video number two of the UFO conundrum. Hopefully less than an hour this time. Jesus Christ, I'm sometimes so elaborate in my bullshit.